Students are always afraid about the Q&A part because we can't really prepare for it. We don't know exactly what they'll say. And they have the wrong idea that a question is an attack on them. They think if someone's asking them a question, someone's trying to kill them. And that may be true, but usually not. Usually it is a compliment to you to get a question, so you should be willing to accept it. In fact, questions have a number of benefits. They get attention, they create interest, they get feedback from the audience that you can use. They make your points easy to remember. They get the audience to interact with each other. They promote new thoughts in you and the audience. Sometimes the Q&A can be the most valuable part of the speech. And I think that this is a cultural difference, too, between Taiwan and international conferences, like in America. In America, when we get a question, we think it's a good thing. But in Taiwan, no one asks me questions. I mean, really, almost never. I've given speeches now, in the last 9 months, I've presented 67 different universities around Taiwan. I'm on the train 3 times every week, just all over. And I probably have gotten, maybe 10 questions total in all of that time. Now, they ask a lot of questions, but they always ask me during the bathroom break, or after, or during the lunch break. You know, I get the questions, and I understand, that's the culture here. There's nothing wrong with that, that's fine. I think that's okay, but I just want to prepare you for the fact that when you go to the conference, that will not always happen. People will ask you questions, they will, and they're not necessarily trying to attack you. It's just that this is the culture, you know, people do ask questions in front of a large audience. Before the presentation, how can you prepare for Q&A? Tell your ideas to a critical friend. You know, ask him to criticize it. Ask him to tell you what he thinks will be your weakness or what he thinks the questions will be. Bring a list of references, you know, for the key papers in your back pocket. Then if someone challenges you, you can bring out the paper and tell him the specific study, because otherwise it's difficult to say, I remember something about that and I think it was, I can't remember it. So at least if you have the backup, hard copy with you, then you can look it up quickly if you need to. Take notes of questions and suggestions that people give you. Don't be afraid to say you don't know the answer to a particular question. Just say you'll research it for them, you'll get back to them. But if you say you'll get back to them, really do get back to them. Because he'll be there next year at the same conference looking for you. He'll say, you didn't answer my question. So you can't avoid him forever. Especially because your domain is very small. Very small. You're definitely going to meet him again. You can also save several slides to answer expected questions, the backup slides we already talked about before. Remember that at the end of your presentation, you actually have two endings, one before Q&A and one after Q&A. We always want to leave our audience on a high note. And when we end after Q&A, sometimes it's very weak. It's, any more questions? No? Are you sure? Okay. Bye-bye. I mean, she's poor. So what you want to do is have a clear, strong ending. We summarize again and then end strong. You know, we can say, here's what we know, A, B, C, thank you, bye-bye. You know, bring it back to an ending close. So we have two closes, one before Q&A, one after Q&A. After the presentation, you can stay behind, too. People will sometimes ask you their real question then, and sometimes that's really the best questions. So don't just start running away as soon as you finish. Kind of hang around outside for a few minutes and then people can come and meet you. Here are 12 ways to encourage questions in your presentation. Again, we like presentations. They're a compliment. They're an honor for us. We want to get people thinking of questions before the end. If the first time they think of a question is at the end of the speech, probably won't be any questions. So we could, for example, announce the question session in a very open conversational way. Look like we want questions. Any questions? Smile. Talk. Don't run away. Second, you can design questions into your content, like into your title. Why knowledge management? Why now? Into your opening. What is the biggest problem facing researchers today? If you're asking them questions, they're thinking with you. They're interacting. They're more likely to ask you. My presentation is about 4 key questions. Considering these facts, how can we not act? You can ask a question,
pause,
then give the answer. That gets them thinking. You can bring up questions you have been asked by other audiences. You can tell the audience at the beginning there's a Q&A. Provide a seating arrangement where people can see each other. This is a really big one. You know, this is, we're in the classroom style right now, and it's very unlikely we will get many questions in this kind of class because people can't see each other. If you can see each other, if the you know, tables are facing each other in some way, much greater interaction. That's why those UK classrooms with the circles on top of each other are so interactive. Everyone's shouting at each other and the teacher who's like in a hole. This like very, very interactive style there because everyone can see everybody all the time. You can list questions in the presentation announcement or brochure. You can provide a whiteboard for people to write down. You can pass out paper for people to write down their question and then give it to you. That's a good way, because then if you get a really angry, nasty question, you can just read a different question. No one knows. You can survive. Don't ask for feedback and then start to run away. You know, look like you want them. Or you could ask for someone to arrange to ask the first question during the Q&A session, like your friend. Here's maybe the best one. Think to yourself what question you hope nobody will ask you and prepare for that question. And then you're more confident about all of them because you know the worst. You're ready for the worst. Why do people ask questions? I want to spend a few moments on this because it's important to understand that not everyone who asks questions has a pure heart. Some people who ask questions have dirty motivations, and in some cases, you don't have to answer every question. I want to be really clear on this. You don't have to stay there fighting a battle that you can never win. So let's take a look at why people ask questions. Number one, and the best one, is because they want to know the answer, right? Of course you should try to answer that question. He really wants to know, and you want to tell him. This is the most common one. Second, because they want to make a point. They want to make their point to the rest of the audience. Again, I'm okay with that. Thank you for your point. That's fine. To impress the audience, they want to show off what they know. That's, again, a motivation for often for questions. Again, I'm okay with that. You're very smart. Thank you. You know, I'm okay. To see if you know the answer. Now we're getting a little bit tougher. He knows. He wants to see if you know. All right? He's testing you. You have no choice but to try to answer this one. If you're wrong, well, maybe he can correct you. You can still survive. To see how you handle questions and stress. How he's pushing you to see if he can make you sweat. To see if he can actually make you nervous. This is very stressful for first-time speakers, particularly for any speaker, but especially for the first-time speakers. Again, you're probably going to have to go ahead and try to do your best and answer it. Smile cheerfully the whole time. The smile will become kind of plastic after a while. To attack your methodology. Now it becomes much more difficult because he's attacking the fundamentals of your paper. In this case, it's hard to deal with methodology issues very quickly. You may want to say, "That's a very interesting question, sir. I would love to talk to you about it after." Never be afraid to say, "Talk to you later." Don't make a fool of yourself in front of this group of people who just listened to you and were impressed by you. This is not the place for a long discussion. You only have 3 minutes. There's no way that you can really get into it enough. You could say, "See me after." Finally, we get into the two that you should not answer. If someone wants to make you look bad, if, for example, they're competing for a job, or competing for a project, or competing for funding, or just a bad person, I don't know why. There's no way to win here. You answer, and he'll keep coming back, and keep coming back. And the only way he can win is if you lose. So there's just not a good way out, and I hate to see PhD students get into this kind of thing. Much better to just say, "See me after," for this kind of thing. Don't go into a war here. Sometimes their questions are actually a personal attack. I have had this myself, and it is no fun. I was doing a speech in Kaohsiung, I won't name the place, last year, and I was giving my speech about technical writing for publication, my research on why papers are rejected by international journals. And there was an older foreign teacher who